Today is October 10th, 1996. This interview is with Mrs. Pearl Barach, née Spiegelstein. The interviewer is Anne Lieb, L-I-E-B, in Brooklyn, New York, the United States of America. The language is English. Hello, my name is Anne Lieb, L-I-E-B, and I'm interviewing Mrs. Pearl Barach on October 10th, 1996. Could you please tell me your name and spell it?
My name is Pearl Barach, B-A-R-A-C, like in candy, H.
Could you please tell me your maiden name and spell it?
My maiden name is Spiegelstein, S-P-I-E-G-E-L-S-T-E-I-N.
Could you please tell me the date of your birth?
December 15th, 1923.
Could you please tell me the town and country of your birth and spell the name of the town?
I was born in Wohyń, Poland. Wohyń, W-O-H-Y-N.
Could you please tell me your father's name and a little bit about your father?
My father's name was Jacob Isaac. And he was a wealthy man. He was a good businessman. And he did everything to make a nice living for us.
Could you tell me a little bit about his business interests?
Yeah, he had rented a mill where they make flour with three more partners. And he sold it to wholesale places, to bakeries, and stores. He made flour.
Was he home a lot with the children?
Not during the day, but he came home early, like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock sometimes, and he spent a lot of time with the children.
Could you please tell me your mother's name and her maiden name?
My mother's name was Bryna Rochel Nissenbaum, N-I-S-E-N-B-A-U-M.
Could you tell me a little bit about your mother? What was she like?
My mother was a good person. She was beautiful, blonde, blue eyes, and she was a good housekeeper. She took good care of the children, and she had a lot of friends, and she was religious.
Could you tell me the names of your siblings and a little bit about them?
My oldest brother was Abraham Chaim, and next to him was Eliezer, and then I was the third, and I had a brother Joshua, and the next was Moshe, and I had a little baby sister. She was born in 1938, Hannah.
Did your brothers go away to yeshiva?
No, but they went to a cheder.
And tell me about your education.
I went to public school, and I finished just before the war broke out. I went to Abbe Jacob School for girls.
What did you study at the public school?
The public school, we studied English, math, writing, reading. We had gym. We learned how to sew, and geography, history, everything but you have to learn.
Did you have classes with Jewish children and Gentile children?
Yes, we did.
How did the Gentile children treat the Jewish children?
Very good. We were very good friends.
Do you remember the names of any of your Gentile classmates?
Yes, I remember one, Zosha, and I can't remember too many.
And the teachers, were they Gentiles?
Mostly were Gentiles. And one Jewish teacher was Regina. I don't remember her name now.
Yeah. How did the Gentile teachers treat the Jewish students?
Very good, the same. no different than the Gentiles.
Did you play with any Gentile children outside of school?
Yes, I had a few friends from school, from the class.
In your town, do you ever remember Gentile children taunting or hitting the Jewish children?
No, I don't remember that, no.
What was the relationship between your father and the Gentiles in the area? Did he do business with them?
Yes, he did. He had a lot of friends, many friends.
How many Jewish families lived in your hometown?
It was around 300, 350, between 300 and 400, I would say.
And how many synagogues were there in the town?
There was one big synagogue, and there was a little, two shtibles.
And where did your family pray?
My family prayed on the holidays, on Shabbos. They prayed in my uncle's shtibel. He gave up a room, a big room, for the holidays and for Shabbos. During the week, they went to the big shul.
And tell me about your Beis Yaakov education.
Oh, in the Beis Yaakov, we learned how to read Hebrew, write Jewish, and we used to go every Saturday. We had a minyan for the girls only, and that's about it.
What was Friday night dinner like in your house?
Friday, my mother used to get up very early. She used to bake challahs and cake, and she cooked, made a field of fish. She cooked and she did everything. And we sat down at the dinner Friday night. My mother lit the candles, and we had my father made kiddush, and we were singing and eating, and we enjoyed it.
And Shabbos morning, you went to the big shul.
Shabbos morning, I went to the Beit Jacob's school. We had a minyan. We davened.
And what did you do in the afternoon?
Oh, in the afternoon, we played with the children, with the friends. And
tell me about the holiday of Passover, Pesach. What do you remember as a child?
Oh, Passover was a very big holiday. We had to change the dishes and do a lot of shopping. We used to bake matzahs. We used to go to a place. They didn't buy ready-made, but they used to go to a special bakery. Everything was kosher. And we had a lot to prepare.
So did you help your mother in the household?
A little bit. She sent me places to shop. You know, and I helped a little, as much I could.
What was the Seder like in your house?
Oh, the Seder, the whole family sat down and they asked the four kashas, and we drank the wine and the filtered fish and everything we ate, and we enjoyed it.
What, did any of the relatives come for that holiday?
No, in Europe, everybody ate by himself. They all had big families, and they ate. In Europe, wasn't like here.
What do you remember about the holiday of Purim?
Purim? Oh, we were fasting. I mean, not me, but they were fasting. And then they made a big seder, and they baked and cooked, and it was a big holiday.
Did you ever wear a costume?
No, I don't remember that.
What do you remember about Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur?
Well, Rosh Hashanah was a holiday, and we went to shul. I did too. And Yom Kippur, we passed.
Could you please tell me your address, where you lived?
I lived on Rinek number 6. It means marketplace number 6. And across the street was a church.
You told me that this was an estate, part of your grandfather's estate.
Oh, we lived in a, yes, my grandfather left an estate. It was like four apartments. My grandmother lived in one with her daughter, Esther Spiegelstein. And then we lived in the front on one side. And then the other front apartment, another sister, my father's, with her husband and children.
What was her name?
Sarah Lieber. And in the back, my father's and niece lived there with the family, with her family. We had a big yard, and my uncle, Sarah Lieber's husband, had a factory from soda and seltzer in the backyard of the house.
How many rooms were there in your apartment?
In my apartment, there were about three rooms. But later on, when my brothers got bigger, they fixed on the attic, they fixed two more bedrooms.
Was there indoor plumbing in this house?
No.
Were you a member of any Jewish organizations?
No.
Did your brothers belong to any Jewish organizations?
No.
Did the town have a rabbi?
Yes.
Do you remember his name?
I forgot. There were two rabbis, and I don't remember the names.
Do you remember anything about them?
Well, they were very religious, with big beards, and they wore white socks and silk coats and a shramble.
And the Gentiles in your area, were they always polite and friendly?
Yes, always. Because they did business with the Jews. And
would you say that the Jews of your community were well off?
Not everybody, but some were well off and some weren't.
When did the troubles first begin?
The troubles first began right after they took over Poland. The Germans came in, they gave orders to bring in all the radios and the valuables and the jewelry and the fur coats, everything. And then after, they burned the whole town. They threw firebombs from planes, and they burned the town.
What do you remember about that day? Were you in the center of town?
Yes, I was in the center of town. And when we heard the bombs, we were running out. And right near my foot, a bomb fell. But I wasn't hurt. And we ran out of town, to the woods, to the farms.
Were any of the Jews killed in that particular bombing?
No, nothing that I remember.
And when did this happen?
This happened right after they took over Poland.
This was in what year?
In 1939, in September.
So your family had to give in valuables at that point?
Yes.
What do you remember your parents giving in?
Well, whatever. My mother had jewelry, and watches, bicycle, and what else? A radio. We had a radio with earphones. And everything.
So after the bombing, what did your family do?
We went to a farm, my father's friend. Benedict Rycerski, R-Y-C-E-R-S-K-I. And we stayed there for a few weeks.
And then what happened?
Then we came to town. My father had he rented the mill from the people. They built a new house. So they gave us their old house, and we lived there. wasn't not really in the center of the town, but it was a little further away.
And where were the other Jewish families at this point?
Well, they all ran wherever they could. Wherever they could, I don't know, but they went to the farms. There were no houses. Not too many were left. Not too many Jewish houses.
So you lived on in this house for how long?
In this house, about a year. My grandmother died there.
And this, what was her name?
Matl Spiegelstein.
And were there any new rules by the Germans? What was life like under the German occupation?
We had to wear an armband with a Jewish star, a white armband with a blue Jewish star, and we could not walk all over. We had to walk in a certain place.
Were the Jewish people permitted to own businesses?
Not no more. No businesses.
Did your father work at this point?
No, he didn't.
So how did the Jews feed their families?
I don't know. They whatever they had, they could buy yet bread and everything. Whatever they had, money left or whatever.
At this time, how were the Gentiles treating your family?
They all promised us if we will need them, they'll hide us. They all promised because we heard what's going on and we knew. We got the food from the Gentiles too. They were on the farm, they had flour, whatever.
Did your father travel to the different farms to get food, or how did you? What was the family doing at this period?
We didn't do nothing. We just got together with the people, during the day, and that's all. But at night, we weren't allowed to go out.
Were you allowed to meet to daven?
Yes, I met to daven. Also, only in the neighborhood. Whatever was in a room, any room. The shul was burned, the shtiblach, everything.
So what happened next? What do you remember next?
Next? My father sent me away to a village. He knew the people, and I used to help in the kitchen.
And what village was this?
Kopina. K-O-P-I-N-A.
And tell me about working.
I helped out in the kitchen. I peeled potatoes. The men was working. I was working. And I used to bring out water for them to drink. And food sometimes. Whatever they needed.
So who was working on this farm? Was it mostly Gentiles or?
Jews, separate. And Gentiles, they were from the poor, but they worked separate. And Ukrainians were watching us. And there was one from Estonia also watching us.
And how long did this go on? How long were you there?
I would say about a year.
And then what happened to the Jews in that area?
There were no Jews in this farm, only the people who came from our town to work. What happened, one day, I didn't sleep in the kitchen where everybody slept. I slept in an attic with my friend, Bargenta. And they start to gather the people, to send out the people to the ghetto Mienzeschätze. And a Gentile told them that we are upstairs in the attic sleeping. And they got us too. They took us out. But one man watched us, me and my friend. But we weren't with the other people yet, but they were going to take us. So I bribed him. I wanted to bribe him. I did. I gave him I had a gold earring, and I had some money, and I gave him. I said, let me run away. Let me go. Me and my friend. He took everything, and then he pulled the gun. He said, you're not going any place. Then somehow he left, and another one came. I had no money, had nothing left, but I said, Vietka, please let me go. Let us go. So he said, you go. So we start. So my friend said, where are you going? He's going to kill you. Why are you running? I said, let's go. Let's take a chance. So we ran. He didn't do nothing. He let us go. So we ran through the fields, and we went into a barn because we didn't want to walk during the day. And we stayed there. We saw the people passing with a horse and buggy. You know, the people who they took them to Mienzeschätze. And when it got dark, we tried to get home to Wohyń. I came home, and my brother was looking for me. They passed our town, they didn't see me. And they were worried about me. They didn't see me with the people. But then I came home, and I thought they were afraid they're going to look for me. They'll come to look for me because I was there and I disappeared. So they sent me to this man again from the mill, and I was there. I was hiding there for a few days in the attic. But they didn't come to look for me.
So did you go home?
Yeah, I went home.
And so your parents at this point were living in the house of
the
mill
house.
Owner?
Yeah, with my brother.
Which brother was this?
This was the older than me, not the oldest. Oldest had a passport, an Irish passport, and he went to Warsaw. And he was like a Polak.
So it was your brother Eliezer that was at home?
Yes.
And where were your Moshe and Joshua?
They killed them too, because they were in a different farm, and they didn't work because they were too young yet. But they slept in an attic by a Gentile, and one Gentile told the Germans that two Jews are sleeping there. They took them out and killed them. They were dead already.
And did your family know that they were dead?
Oh yes, sure.
What was the mood of your parents when they heard what had happened to your brothers?
Well, you could imagine, but it was, they were very bad, very bad.
Were many Jews being killed?
Yeah, they used to come in town and take out the Jews and put them in the mud and beat them, but until then, not so many. Only when the Poles used to say, they didn't know who's Jewish or not. Germans didn't know. But the Poles helped them a lot.
And what happened to your baby sister?
My baby sister, they had to take, they gave orders right in the beginning that they should take out the small children to a town, Parchev. Parczew. My aunt, my father's sister, went with her, and we never saw them again.
And you never received any communication
no.
from them?
No, nothing.
So what happened next to your family?
One day, the Germans came into town, and they start shooting around the houses, near the houses. And I went into a corner. I covered myself with a basin, my face. They didn't see me, but I was in a corner sitting, but I still wanted to protect my head and face. And my brother, Eliezer, he jumped out the window, and he was shot to death.
When were you able to come out of the house?
Soon after they left, the same day. They killed then a lot of people.
What did the Jewish people do with the dead bodies of their family members?
They buried them. We ran to look for a place where to hide, but when we saw this was going on, my father had a lot of friends. They all promised him. But when it came, they were afraid, or they didn't want to do it. So we had to come back.
At one point, did the Germans make you make all the Jews come into a small area in your hometown? Did they form a small ghetto?
This was a small ghetto. This was like in the outskirts of the town. It wasn't in the center. But a few houses weren't burned, so they let us stay there. We weren't allowed to go all over.
Was there barbed wire around?
No.
Did you have a curfew every night?
Yes.
About how many Jews lived in these houses?
I don't know, not too many. I don't know what happened to them. They went maybe to different towns. There wasn't much room there. Maybe to some Gentile people, I really don't know.
Did anybody guard the Jews in these houses?
No.
Did the men have to work?
Oh, they took some people to work, but they sent them to camps, to concentration camps, to working camps, maybe. I don't know.
What happened to your family next?
Next, they took us to the ghetto, to Międzyrzece.
How far away was?
A few hours by horse and buggy.
So did they take everyone together, or did you have to hire someone?
I don't remember how we went on a horse and buggy, but I don't know what they did. They did, you know, if they hired. They told the people to get out of town, to go to Międzyrzece. I guess everybody hired a horse and buggy, and we went.
What did you take with you?
Not much. We didn't have much because everything was burnt, and you could not buy. There were no stores.
So where did you stay in this ghetto?
In this ghetto, at the end of the ghetto, or the beginning, there was a little house, and we stayed there. And we paid somebody to build a double wall in case something will happen, we'll hide there.
We have to change tapes now.
Okay, how did I do?
Tape number 2, October 10th, 1996, interview with Mrs. Pearl Barach. Tell me a little bit about life in the ghetto.
Oh, we had friends from our town. It was hard. We didn't have too much food. We couldn't get too much. And I met with friends. And then I got typhus. I was very sick for a few weeks. And one night, I don't know if it was true or if it was a dream, I dreamt that I went up. And my brother opened the door, and he said, "What are you doing here? Go home." My mother thought I'm dying already. I was very sick. He said, "Tell mother not to cry." It didn't hurt me much. It's just like a burn with a match. And he said, "And I'm very happy here, but you go home," he said. And he said, "The only thing, I was embarrassed when Gentile people buried me."
Did you have a very high fever?
I was very sick, I guess so. I didn't know what I was doing. And then I woke up and I told my mother, you know, I just saw Eliezer. And she said, don't talk, don't talk, you're too weak. But I said, no, I have to tell you what I saw and what he told. You should cry. And that didn't hurt him. And it was, you know, when he opened the door, I saw all the people with beards, religious people, and they were praying. And he was like the leader. And he said he was very happy there. I told this to my mother.
How did he look in the dream?
Very good. Very good. He looked happy. He told me he was happy.
Did he look young?
Yeah, he was young, sure. He looked the same like he looked when he was alive.
Did many people get typhoid in the ghetto?
Yes.
Did many people die at that point?
This I don't remember.
Was there a gate around this ghetto?
Yes, near our house. It was the end of the ghetto. It was barbed wires around the ghetto.
Who was guarding the ghetto?
Jewish police. Inside, outside, I don't know, we weren't allowed to go outside the ghetto.
Were people allowed to go out of the houses at night?
No, we did not go out.
Did you ever see any Germans coming into the ghetto?
Sometimes they came in, but they did, I remember. They killed people.
Did you see killings on the streets?
No.
Did you ever witness any beatings in the ghetto?
Oh, yes.
Who was doing the beatings?
The Germans.
Did they just pick people to beat, or?
They just told people to get out on the outside, and they beat them up. They called them for, you know, they send them away to camps, to concentration camps. Slowly, before they liquidated the whole ghetto.
Tell me about liquidation of the ghetto.
It was in April 1943, when the Warsaw ghetto uprising started. They start shipping out, taking out the people and send them to concentration camps. We had this wall. When we heard all the commotion and the shooting, they were shooting a lot. So we went down to this place, to the double wall. It was very tight and very hot. Very miserable, but we tried to survive. And then when it got quiet, we went out, and our house was right near the wires. So we crossed, there was a little river, and we crossed the river and we started walking to our town. It was quite, we walked during the night, and during the day we stayed in the woods, in the forest, whatever we can. What we ate, I don't remember. And we took a few days, about a week maybe, and we came, because everybody was always promising us they will hide us and they will take care of us. But when it came, my father went to the different, you know. Yeah, my brother also, I forgot to tell you that my brother came to the ghetto. He was he had a Polish passport, but he didn't hear. Once in a while, he sent a letter and he gave it to the Jewish police or through somebody, not he. He sent a letter, not through the post. But he didn't hear from us for a long time. He was worried. and he came into the ghetto. And he knew the policemen, they were friends, the Jewish policemen. So they let him in, and he came and stayed already with us. So this brother picked up the wires, and we all crawled under the wire, and we escaped. And we tried to walk during the night, because the Germans, you didn't see them during, they were afraid too. And nobody saw it, nobody saw it. And it took, and then we didn't know what to do. We had no place where to go, we lost everything. So we said, we are going back to the ghetto. So we went back to the ghetto, we were wandering around about 3 weeks, back and forth. And we came to the ghetto, we didn't have our house. The ghetto was made smaller. So we didn't have the wall. And a month later was another, they liquidated again, the other people who were left. Some people survived the first, and then the first transport. And then they told us all to go on the market, all the people. And everybody, my brother had this passport, so he tried to put it in a loaf of bread. And other people put money, this, other things, maybe jewelry, I don't know. But the Germans took away all the breads, everything, but we had nothing. And they took us to Majdanek.
They collected you in the marketplace,
yeah.
And then what happened?
Then took us to the trains. We walked to the stations, and they put us in cattle cars. And we were talking. My mother said, how old am I? I'm 42 years old, 42, 43. It was 1943. She was young yet. And my two brothers were, oh, not two brothers, one. The oldest brother.
What was the name of the brother that was
Abraham
with you?
Chaim, the one who had the passport. And we were talking, and there was a little window, only one little window in this car. And before the station, the train slows down. So my father said, he'll jump, and my brother will jump. I'll jump after him, and my mother will jump after me. So my father jumped, and my cousin was there, Shimon Friedman. So my father jumped, and my brother, and his cousin jumped, and my mother said, Perle, you jump? I said, no, I can't. I'm not going to jump. Because I could not take it. The wandering around and no place where to go. I said, whatever will happen, it'll happen. And my mother didn't jump either. And my father's sister, with this little boy, was there too.
What was her name?
Sarah Luber. With the little boy, I don't even remember.
And were there any other relatives in the car with you?
Yes, my mother's sister, Pearl. Her name was Pearl. She was older than me.
How did they get out of that little window to jump?
They opened the window, they jumped. It was big enough to get through. And the train was going very slow before every station slowed down.
Did you hear any Germans shooting them? Did the Germans see them escape?
No, we couldn't hear because they were on the roofs watching with the guns. But I don't know. They were all right. My cousin told me that my father had a little scratch on the nose, and they got together. They got together, walking, and then they walked to our town again. When they came through the fields. They walked at night, and during the day they stayed any place. So they came to our town, to a farm, and they knew who it was, and it was a big barn, it was a barn there, and they went in there. And they stayed during the day. The owner came, Viktor Manovitz was his name, he came in. He said, my father said to him, Victor, bring me a piece of bread. He said, okay, at night I'll bring you a piece of bread. He came with a gun at night, and he started with my brother. And my father said, Victor, what are you doing? What are you doing? So he killed him, and then he killed my father. And my cousin, it was dark, and my cousin hid in the bushes. He could not find him. And when I came home, he told me all about it. How it happened.
And you, meanwhile, were still in the cattle car.
Yes, I was in the cattle car, and they took us.
How many days did the cattle car travel?
I really don't. It wasn't so far, maybe a day.
What do you remember when the cattle car door opened?
When the cattle car opened, we had to walk like from Lublin. It stopped in Lublin. Majdanek is about 3 kilometers, so we had to walk all this way. We came in to the concentration camp. We had to take off. First, they made a selection. My mother was holding this little, my father's nephew, my cousin, and his mother was holding by one hand. So they took them with the children, with all the people. They were still young, but they took them with the all. And me, they selected, I guess, for work, and my mother's sister, too, came with me. And then we took off the clothes. We went to the showers, took off the clothes, everything, and they looked us over. And we took showers. They gave us clean clothes, different clothes, one long big shoe, one small shoe, one high heel, one low heel. And then they took us to the barracks.
What were the barracks like?
The barracks like wood, how do I say it in English? Like bunk beds. One bed, just boards, one after the other. A lot. They were big and a lot of people in each. There was a Stubmeldeste. She took care of the people.
Was she a Jew or a Gentile?
I think they were Jews. Some were Jews.
And how did she act, the one in your barracks?
In my barracks, not too good, but she had orders. She had to obey the orders, too.
What time did you have to wake up in the morning?
Early.
Was there a roll call?
A what?
Roll call. A tzel appel?
Yes, sure. Oh, yes. Every morning. We had to stand there and they counted if everybody's here. Yes, and then they took us to work.
What type of work did you do?
Well, we put, there were stones on one side. They told us to take it in a different direction. And then the next day they told us to take it someplace else and then to the same place, back and forth, just to keep us busy.
Who was guarding you while you worked?
Oh, the Germans.
Were you ever beaten?
Oh, yes, a few times.
Did you see anyone being shot?
Shot? I saw they hung one girl. They took us all out, the whole camp, from all the barracks, and they were going to hang her. And they said to us, don't say nothing, don't scream, don't yell, because, and they said that she tried to escape. And if anybody will try to escape, they'll do the same thing. And they left her hanging like this. She was overnight. It was very sad.
Did you see? Did many of the girls die?
Oh yes, many. They took them out. They didn't die inside. They took them to. They had like a little hospital. Infirmary, whatever they called it.
What was the number of your barrack?
I don't remember now. But I know we had on the cloth. We didn't have a number on the arm, but on the cloth we had a KL, concentration camp, in German, Konzentrationslager.
What type of food did they give you to eat?
In the morning, we had black coffee. In the afternoon, they gave us a soup with horse meat. And at night, they gave us a slice of bread. So with this, some people couldn't sleep because they had a piece of bread. They were hungry. I used to try to save a little piece for the morning, and I left for the morning. I should be, you know, not so hungry.
Do you remember the names of any of the women that were in your barrack with you in Majdanek?
Oh, yeah. She was already married. She was Leah and Pearl. This Pearl Rosenzweig, Esther and her sister. Yeah, I knew a lot of Malke.
Did the girls give each other courage?
Well, we always were thinking we'll survive. And, you know, but it was very sad. But we saw what's going on.
What did you talk about with your friends while you were there?
We talked about the home. We have nobody. We're all alone. And what happened to our parents and this and that, you know, all kinds of. We didn't have much time to talk because we were working in the fields with the stones, carrying stones and brick, whatever they had there. Not just because they needed it, but they wanted us to work for nothing. And at night, you know, we had to go be inside. We could not get out. After that appeal, at night they also made an appeal. They counted twice a day.
And how long did it take at nighttime? Were you outside of the barracks?
No, at night, no. Weren't allowed.
Did you ever witness any act of kindness while you were in Majdanek?
From the Germans? No.
Was anyone particularly cruel?
Well, they were all cruel, but we tried not to get near them. We stayed away. Yeah, they were beating people, the men mostly. We saw the men from far. They had different camps. They were in different, men with men and women with women. Yeah, I saw them. They beat a lot of people.
Were a lot of people dying around you?
No, they, as I told you, they took them to the hospital, like.
Did they have selections?
Oh, yes, yes, they had selections.
Could you tell me about that?
They told us to get out, and we stayed, and they, you know, they looked over the people, they took away some. All the people and whoever they wanted.
Where did they take those people?
I don't know. They probably took them to other camps, to Auschwitz maybe. I don't know. They just took them away.
And where?
Or maybe they burned them maybe to the ovens. I don't know. We didn't see that. Like, how could you see it? I saw the ovens.
What were the ovens like?
The oven was like a big oven, and that's all. I don't know what they, you know.
So where did they take you? Where? How did you leave Majdanek?
How I left Majdanek? I was there about 4 weeks to a month, and they registered people to go to the, I mean, to work to ammunition factories. But we could not believe them. But my aunt, and I went to work, and my aunt was very mad at me. She said, where did you go today? They registered people to leave this camp, Majdanek. I said, you know what? In the afternoon, I won't go, and I'll register. When I registered, she said, what did you do? You're going to death. I said, and what are you here? Not for that? I figured that I'll jump And I knew where my father was supposed to go, to this Benedict Lutzerski. So I said, she says, because of me, she has to go too. I said, if you want to go, you go. If you don't want to go, because of me, you don't have to go. But I'm going. But then they selected people, they looked us over. We had to strip, take off everything. She did too. I passed, she didn't. But then I came to the, I didn't jump. They took us to Skarzysko from there.
And how did you go from Majdanek?
They took us in the trains.
Was it a cattle car again?
Yes, always with a cattle car.
And how long were you in the cattle car this time?
I don't remember. From Majdanek to... It was quite a few days, without food, without nothing, because it was far. Lublin from...
About how many girls were in the cattle car with
you? It was packed. I don't know how many, but it was packed.
Were you able to sit down?
I don't remember that, but it was packed.
Did people talk to each other?
Yes, we talked. But we still didn't believe. We didn't know where are we going. They told us that we're going to the ammunition factory, but we didn't know anyway. But I didn't want to jump.
So tell me what happened when the doors opened up again.
When the doors opened up, there were police, there police, Germans, and they took us to this camp. There were three camps, Berg A, Berg B, and Berg C. A was the best one. The B was, I don't know, but the C, they put in the we made the shells. And in the gun, they put in the powder. Over there, and the people got so yellow, they didn't have a bed, showers there. They used to take us to our camp to get showers, take showers. They were so yellow, like an egg yolk, from the powder. From the gunpowder, right.
So you were in Camp A?
I was in Camp A.
And how many factories were there?
Oh, it was a big, big place. They took us with guards. They took us in the morning. And they brought, and we came back at night, also with guards. But 1 week I worked nights. They worked 24 hours a day, and 1 week days.
Were the conditions of this camp better than Majdanek?
It was different. It was smaller barracks. There were smaller barracks, and we could go outside and talk to friends. And we were talking, what would we talk about, what happened to us? There's nothing else to talk. We had nobody, no. They gave us food, a little better than Majdanek. A sweet soup every day, and a coffee in the morning, the same thing, a piece of bread, about the same. And they made selections. Oh, yes.
Tell me about the selections.
They told us to go outside, and to line up, and they looked us over. Not naked. But like this, whoever they didn't like, say, I don't know where they took them.
So you never heard from them, the ones
no,
that were...
No. First of all, I didn't know everybody, but from my town, they were with me. A few people survived.
So about how many girls slept in the barracks?
How many girls? I don't know, maybe, who knows, 50, 60. I really don't remember how many. I remember one woman was pregnant and she had a baby on the bed, on the bunk bed, if you want to call it a bed. And she had a baby, a little boy, and we were looking, and she didn't even She didn't say nothing. She had a baby, and they left it, and it got blue, and it died. They didn't do nothing to it.
Were there men in this camp?
Yeah, yeah. But the men had separate barracks.
And what type of work did they do?
Well, they worked in the ammunition factories.
Did you ever see any beatings?
Oh, yes. I was beaten once.
Could you tell me about it?
This was the Meister, a German. He wore civilian clothes. And you know, you made the 40 millimeter, the shells, they were so big. And when they don't come out right, they have a little scratch, they're not good. But by the time you pick it up, they're very hot when they come out. And by the time you pick it up, there are a few more schmelts, they used to say. No good. So he hit me in my face. In the eye, in the face.
Do you have sail appels here too?
Appels? No, we went outside because we didn't go by ourselves to the factory with the guards. I guess it was an appel.
What do you remember about the winter time?
Oh, the winters were bad. We didn't have much warm clothes and with no stockings. Whatever we came from Majdanek, that's all. That's what we had. No stockings, no hats, no gloves, nothing. And we were freezing.
Did you have a coat?
No.
Did you have a blanket?
Blanket we had. Oh, I covered myself with a sack from flour they gave, you know, from sugar.
We have to change tape now.
I don't know how I'm doing, Cam.
Tape number 3, October 10th, 1996, interview with Mrs. Pearl Barach. So what happened next?
From Tkarzysko, we stayed there. I would say they took us out in June.
Of what year?
In 43, I think. No. Yes, 43, right. And they took us to Częstochowa.
And where was this?
This was not far from the German border. They were also ammunition factories there.
And this was also a camp? You were in a camp over
yes,
there?
Yes, the same camp for ammunition. It was a camp, and then they took us to work, you know, every day and brought us back. We walked, you know, we had to walk. And I stayed there, you know, they thought they'll take us out to Germany, right, because the Russians came closer. But they could not cross the Wisla River near Warsaw. That was a suburb of Warsaw. So they couldn't, it took them 6 months to cross. So we stayed there and worked the 6 months. Once they crossed Warsaw, they tried to ship us out to Germany. They shipped out not everybody at one time because there were a lot of people. And they also had three factories there, three camps. Perzeri, Wartaberg, and Częstochowianka. And I was in the Wartaberg, near the Warta River. And I saw once, there was a Wartenschlager, his name was. I don't know, a man was standing there and he did something, he probably said he did something wrong, they didn't, So he put them near the border with a guard, and he had to look into the water for so long till he fell in and he drowned. This I saw myself.
So who was guarding the workers over
the,
here?
The German, Ukrainian.
Did any of them show any act of kindness?
Now that I know.
Were there beatings here too?
Yes, sure. If you did something for the ammunition factory, if they didn't come out right, it was your fault.
How many hours a night were you able to sleep?
Well, we had enough time, but who could sleep? We could not sleep. We slept on one bed, three people. Who could sleep?
So how long were you here?
I was there about 6 months. July. Right, about 6 months. And then when they crossed the river and they start coming closer, they tried to send people to Germany or the other camps, I don't know. And not every day, but not everybody at the same time. They couldn't, too many people. And it came to my turn. So they took us and they put us in a big barn and they locked us up and they said we are waiting for the trains. And we were waiting and waiting and waiting. And they opened the doors and they said, you going back to the barracks, to the camp, and as that I have good sign. You'll be happy. We come to the camp, we don't see any Germans. They all ran away. The Russians came in, but they didn't do nothing for us because they were fighting. They were chasing them, the Germans. And there were a lot of people, mature people, lawyers, doctors in camp. This was in the evening already. He said, let's stay overnight. We have no place where to go. We'll see what to do in the morning. And they had speeches, we are liberated, and this, And the morning we went out just to see what's going on outside. So the Polish people, they didn't know what happened. The soldiers were laying dead, the Russians and Germans on the ground. They were fighting. And the people asked us, Did they let you out, Jews? So we said, no. The Germans ran away. They left us. We were there just another few days. And I said, my brother jumped, my father, maybe they're alive. And we tried to go back. I tried. And my other friends, too. We survived from our town, friends. And we tried to get back, but we stayed here a few days. I don't know, I don't remember what we ate. We had no food either. And then we went on the trains, but they transport wood. There were no walls, no nothing, no roof, only four poles in each corner pole, four poles. And we were like squeezed like a box of sardines. We could not sit down, we could not stand up, and we had everything we had to do, and we had no clothes, not too much. I had a little raincoat, not lined, and it was in January. And in Poland, it's cold. And we came to I don't know how long it took, maybe a day or two, and we came to a station, Lukov. It was a nice Jewish town, but this wasn't in town, the station. And we already got in, they let us in the passenger trains. And we went home. It was a few hours, maybe 2 hours to get home by train to the station was called Bezbola, our town. And we got off, I saw people, they recognized me, Gentiles. They recognized, everybody wanted to take us home. So we got on the, you know, on the buggy, and they took us home. But there's no, I had no home, but then when I came to my street, I saw my cousin, the one who jumped from the train, he survived. And I said, Shimon, Shimon, I started yelling, Shimon, and he was looking at me, where is she coming from? He didn't know, they were liberated in 1944.
And this was, you were liberated when?
45 in January, the 17th or the 18th, I think it was the 17th. And I was yelling, he recognized me and he came over. And he said, you know, Shulam is alive, your cousin Shulam and his wife. I said, oh, that's good. I said, where is my father and brother? He didn't answer me. So I asked him again. He said, if you're not going to say nothing, don't yell, don't scream. And he told me the story of what happened. The Pollock killed them. And
did you see the Polish man that killed your father and brother? Was he still in the town?
Well, I didn't stay too long in the town because we were afraid to stay there after, because I stayed 4 weeks, but I didn't see him because we didn't go there so far, you know. But he told me who it was. He knew.
And tell me what happened there in your hometown.
Yes, I was there about 4 weeks. And I looked a little bit, I gained a little weight. I stayed with my cousin and his wife. She was 4 months pregnant. And there were another few Jews there, a few other house, not there, not by us. I stayed with them for 4 weeks. And one night, it was Purim night, my cousin put up fish to cook because we had to go make a cider. And I was laying down on the day bed in the kitchen. And I put up water to warm. I was going to wash my hair. And I heard a knock in the door. I heard a knock and I opened the door and he asked me if he could have some water. I got up. I gave him a glass of water, and he was holding the water in his hand, and he went towards the door to the bedroom because my cousin always had the Russian soldiers there. They used to come in to him, so he was checking. And as soon as he saw there was no one there, he put away the glass, and he said, raise your hands, and he pulled his gun. And don't say nothing. So we did. He told us to go in to the bedroom. To the man, he said, lay down, face on the floor, face down. The women, too. And to me, you know, was sitting on a chair like this with a gun holding. I saw one man. And then other men came. They were dressed in Polish uniforms. This was the Armia Krajowa, National Army, an underground army. They didn't like Jews. And there were another few men, and I guess some were guarding outside. I don't know. I didn't see. But I know because they were watching them. And they start looking in the closets and taking out things. And he asked me, he told me to sit down near the table. I was, you know, I'm short. I was sit down and asked me my name. I told him. And he asked me where I was. I said I was in the concentration camps. He said, yes, how long? I said, almost 2 years. He said, yes, you suffered in concentration camp and now you're going to jail. I said to him, I am not afraid to go to jail. I did nothing wrong. And I prayed to God they should send me to jail because I saw something else. I saw the guns and everything. So then after this, they were here. I could not tell time because every minute it's like a year. And they told me also to lay down to face. And they went in to load up the guns, machine guns. and they start shooting. Yeah, and my cousin said to me and to the other girls, scream, yell, scream. You know, we should start. And nothing like God wanted me to live. Nothing came out of me. I could not scream. I wanted really to scream, but I could. Nothing came out. And the people were screaming. And they killed them all, 6 people. And I was the only survivor.
What were the names of the people in that apartment that were killed?
My cousin's name was Shulim Chenki. His wife was Frida Chenki. She was 4 months pregnant. My other cousin was Shimon Friedman, Pearl Rosenzweig, Ritka Monchas, and a little boy. He was 7 years old. He survived with his mother and a Polish passport. They were in Warsaw. But at that night, he was 7 years old. He was so gorgeous. And at this night, they didn't have much room where they stayed. She stayed with other people. So she sent them to us. And he asked me if he can sleep over here. I said, oh, of course. So that's why he was there. And they killed all the 6. His name was Kramash, the second I remember. I don't remember the first.
So what happened? Where did you go after this?
We were afraid already. I don't know who buried them, but, you know, I was all shaken up. And then we went to a different town, to Radzin. And we stayed there. The people who survived, they didn't want to stay in this town anymore. We were afraid. And we lived there with people.
How did the Polish people treat the Jews after the war?
While we were staying there, he brought us, one friend brought us food, butter, bread. But they had anyway, my cousin had everything. And then in Radzin too, they used to bring me. And he was very nice to me, the man who from whom we rented the mill. They were nice to me too. They wanted me to stay with them. When I came home from concentration camp, they wanted me to stay with them, but I said, I'm going to stay with Gentiles if I have a cousin, a Jew. So I didn't.
Did you travel a lot through Europe?
Yes, I went to Katowice. I had a friend living in Międzyrzece, where we had the ghetto. It was no more ghetto. And I went to visit. Not too much. Once they killed them, I was all alone again. I went to Katowice. I stayed there. And in 1946, we went to Czechoslovakia. And we came to Germany.
And where did you stay?
In Germany, in a DP camp, in Bad Reichenhall, in Bavaria, and in the Alps. It was close to the Austrian border.
How were the Jews treated in the DP camp?
In the DP camp, they were treated. They got food and everything, and clothes. They were treated good.
What was the mood of the Jews? Where did they want to go from the DP camps?
Some went to Israel, and some wanted to go to America. We really wanted to go to Israel. But my husband had relatives, and they kept on writing to us that they want us. And in the meantime, they sent us to Savannah, Georgia.
So. Tell me about the day you met your husband. What was your husband's name?
Sam. Itamar in Hebrew. How I met him, he came to this DP camp. He used to live in Perth. by Nuremberg. And he used to come do business with cigarettes. You know, they had to live. So he used to come by there. I met him. And my friend was also married to his landsman.
Tell me about the wedding. Who married you?
Who married? I'm a rabbi in a hotel in Barach, a little town. Yes, that was not a concentration camp. It was a DP camp. This was the Americans.
Did Jewish life resume after the war?
Yes, they had shuls, they had everything.
So tell me about when you came to the United States. Where did you go?
I went to, they sent me to Savannah, Georgia. And I was pregnant when I came. First we came to New Orleans. And they were waiting for us. And they made us a big party. We came with, on the boat, I remember, General Hershey. Also army boat. And the women took us around, showed us New Orleans. And then they took us to the station. And we came to Savannah. Other people waited for us because we didn't speak English and we didn't know where, the country. And they put us in a hotel for a few days until they found an apartment for us.
So you became part of the Jewish community?
Yes, we became. There were three shuls there. Every Friday we went for an Onyx Shabbat. There was a Reformed, a Conservative, and an Orthodox shul. And they treated us very nice, very nice.
And how long did you stay there?
In Savannah, Georgia, about 2.5 years. And my husband wanted to go because he had relatives there.
So you moved?
We moved, right. I had only one baby. He was 2 years and 1 month old.
And you went to Brooklyn?
I went, yes, to Brooklyn. We got a furnished apartment, and he got a job in a luncheonette. He worked in Savannah, Georgia, too. They gave him a job.
Was life good for you and your husband in America?
Yes, was good until he started making a little more money.
When you were raising your children, did you tell them the stories, your experiences?
No, I could not. When they were small, I could not. I don't think I ever told them the whole story. Anyway, I cannot talk about it. But they know.
Tell me about your sons. What did you try to teach them? What was important for you to teach them while they were growing up?
They should be honest, good people. And they went to school, they finished, and I sent them to a yeshiva, but not when they were very small. And I tried to teach them the best I could.
Do you think about your family?
Yes, I always think. I was very young when I lost both parents, the whole family. I lost everything.
What memories or visions come to your mind about your family?
Well, I had a good life when I was home before the war. I had everything I needed and everything I wanted. We were very comfortable. And happy, played with my brothers. Sometimes we were fighting, you know, like children. But they were very protective of me. Because for my little sister was, I was one and four brothers. And then my little sister was born 1938, but until then, They were very protective of me.
Do you have nightmares?
Well, sometimes I do.
What do you dream about in
well,
your nightmares?
Sometimes I'm concentration camp, they're chasing me, I'm running.
Do you ever feel joy?
No, I'm always sad. In the beginning, when my husband was alive, it was different. Now it's different too. When the children were small, I was busy, you know, with them. I tried to do the best, everything for them. They should be taking good care, and that's it.
What message do you have for future generations about your experiences?
They should never forget what happened, and they should not let it happen. It is true, I was there.
I'd like to thank you very much for sharing your story with me today. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. This picture is my brother Eliezer's from before the war. He sent it to Israel in 1938. This is a picture from before the war from my class. From Beit Jacob. I am on the top row, the fourth. This is a picture taken in Bad Reichenhall in the P camp, and I am on the bottom row, the second from left. This is a picture from my wedding. My husband, Sam Barach, it was taken by the Reichenhall in 1949, April 10th. This is a picture, me and my husband, we took a cruise to Bermuda in 1991 in May. You can see his number on his left arm. From concentration camp. This is the whole picture for my family taken at the wedding, Alan's wedding. From top row, from the left, it's Ali, my daughter-in-law, David, my son, Alan, and my daughter-in-law, Kathy, and my middle son, Robert. And standing from left on the bottom is my grandson, Michael. My husband, Sam, is sitting, and I'm next to him. This is my granddaughter, Samantha, and my grandson, Jake.
Mrs. Barach, could you please introduce your son to us?
This is my son, Alan Mark Barach.
Hello.
Do you have a special message for your mother or something you'd like to share with us?
First, I'd like to say that I love her very much. And I thought she was probably going to kill me when I encouraged her to do this tape, but I think one of the values that we'll get out of this down the line is that to see, I know it wasn't easy for her, but for my children and their children and schools or wherever these tapes are viewed, they can look down 100 years from now and see that somebody, that wasn't in vain. She came over, she survived, and I think the hardest part of her surviving, and my father as well, was daily, was what they did was to push the family to rebuild, really to rebuild. And going forward, and I'm thankful for it because I'm here and my our grandchildren, great-grandchildren, generations that I won't see, can know that there was one limb left on the tree, and hopefully that will sprout again.
Thank you so much.
3 minutes.